Well, on behalf of the Waltner family, thank you for coming to celebrate the life of Ray Waltner. You know, Ray lived a good, long life, and we're celebrating his life today, but we also recognize that today it can be very comfortable to talk about a loss. Everyone has a different way of grieving. Everyone has a different way of processing the changes that come when we lose someone that we care about very deeply. You know, many of us have known Ray for decades, and for the family, they've never known a life without Ray, and so the loss is very real, and we're going to talk more about that a little bit later. I had the privilege of meeting the Waltner family over 50 years ago in the church, the old part of the church. Ray was my Sunday school teacher, and I got a chance to meet the Waltner family, and one of the things I learned about the Waltner family, I'd be there, and my mom would take me, and Annie would cut my hair. And so those of you that know the little house on the river, I would sit in the kitchen, and Annie would cut my hair, and Tim and I are about the same age, and we kind of grew up to school together, so I'd be there with the family. And one thing I learned is that they had these family reunions, and probably some of you have been in those reunions, and you remember those. And what I learned is that Ray loved a good family reunion. Ray loved it. And so I think it would be very helpful today for us and very honoring to Ray if we would consider this time that we have together today as a family reunion. And really, it's a family reunion in every sense of the word. We have Waltner family coming from all around today. We have friends from church. You know, as those of you that grew up with Ray in the church, you know that we're brothers and sisters in Christ. But at the same time, really, we're all here because of our love and affection for Ray and his love and affection for us. And so we really are family in every sense of the word. So here we are, one big family today. And because we're family, I want you to know that you have the freedom to process the loss of Ray in just the way that you need. See, your family around you understands. So today, during this time, you may experience many emotions. You may cry. That's okay. We're here with family. It's okay to cry with family. You may find that you smile or laugh about something that was maybe in the slide deck earlier or afterwards. It's okay to smile and laugh. You may find that you cry and laugh at the same time. And that's okay. We're family, it's safe. Now, one thing we are not going to do today is we're not going to process the loss of Ray in isolation. We're not going to do that because we're all here together. We're going to collectively support the immediate family, and we're going to collectively support each other. We're here together. What we do here today is a very significant part of the healing process. So let's take advantage of our time together. Let's love on each other. Let's visit. Let's enjoy each other. Let's share food later. Let's grieve together. Let's be family together. Now, oftentimes during a memorial service, there's an open microphone where people share about the one they lost. And the Waltner family would like you to know that there will be an open microphone, but it won't be in this part of the service. It's going to be over in the time later when we're sharing food. And so if today, while we're doing this part of the service, you have a memory come to mind or a thought, something that you'd like to share, just hang on to it. And you'll have a chance to share that later. The only thing the family would ask is that it be something very uplifting and that you try to limit it to a couple minutes. We could have a lot of people that want to share, and we want to give everybody a chance. So let's begin our service by bowing our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you for your presence today. We thank you that you are here with us. We ask that you'd be here with us in our grief, that you'd be here with us to process the loss. We thank you for the Waltner family. We thank you for everything that Ray has meant to each one of us in so many ways. He's a gift to us, and we thank you for him. Be with us today with your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. So Ray, as you know, many of you know, was a fearless song leader. And so the family has picked out a couple of hymns that Ray enjoyed, and Bill's going to lead us in those songs. Now, when you came in on the service bulletin, there's a little handout inside. If you want to pull it out, it's got the words to the song, to both songs. So grab that, go ahead and stand, and we'll sing these songs with Bill.
Take it in that on the cross. On Monday, January 23rd, heaven got a little brighter with the passing of our beloved father, grandpa, uncle, and friend, Raymond Waltner. He was born on July 12, 1929, the youngest of five children to Joseph Waltner and Anna Graber Waltner in Monroe, Washington. He graduated from Monroe High School in 1948, where he played baseball and lettered in football. He served in the Army from January 1951 to February 1953, starting at Camp Rucker, Alabama, before being stationed in Weejambu as a military policeman during the Korean War. Ray had many different jobs as a young man. He sold nap shoes, life insurance, and men's clothing, drove a school bus, worked for Safeway and Marv's Apparel before ultimately going to work selling hardware at Coast to Coast. After retirement, he never quit being active in Christian ministries and lending a hand to anyone in need. He had lots of dear friends. Many of them, though not blood related, considered him family.
On March 6, 1953, he married the love of his life, Annie Stuckey, and soon after, they made their home in Snohomish. There they raised five kids, living in the same house the entire 50 years of their marriage, until Annie's passing in October of 2003. Ray would continue living there until the last year of his life. Both Ray and Annie were active in their church, the Gideons and prison ministries at the Monroe Reformatory. He made a huge impact on the lives of so many people because he truly cared about them, no matter what kind of past they had. No one was a stranger to him. One of his missions in life was to share his faith in God. The other was to make people happy. He had many funny sayings that will be carried on by his kids and grandkids and great-grandkids. His family used these words to describe him. So I'll go a little slow so you can think of a memory with that word. He was very funny, loving. Sorry, he was loving, considerate, positive, determined, kind-hearted, generous, consistent, joyful, genuine, selfless, resilient, playful, forgiving, compassionate, calming, non-judgmental, witty, strong, and an avid storyteller. He will be greatly missed until we see him again.
I want to share one of Grandpa Ray's favorite verses. And for those of you that know him, this is how he lived his life with this verse. Psalms 18:2. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold.
Good morning. My name is Ben Ost, and I do share a particular kinship with who was my Uncle Ray. I'm the youngest of our family. I am here representing the family of Danny and Ruby Ost. And we were always very close, especially when my parents were here and they did missionary work in Mexico. I remember back in, from stories, of course, I wasn't there. When my parents met, my Uncle Ray was my mom's youngest brother, but they quickly became close friends with my dad. And in 1949, my parents went to Mexico to be missionaries and lived down there, worked down there, raised and had 8 children. I'm the youngest, and that's where my kinship with Uncle Ray. And the memories I have of Uncle Ray were just, well, he was very funny and witty and always very, I never saw him shaken up. He was always very steady. And that was always a blessing to me and an encouragement. The families that he touched are many. My parents, particularly in Mexico, had the privilege of being used by God to bring the gospel to, some say, over 100,000 people in Mexico that have come to know the Lord through their ministry. And Uncle Ray was a very real part of their ministry when they were alive. They passed on, but the encouragement he gave them every time they met, every time we would come to see my Uncle Ray, my grandma, it was always such an incredible blessing and an encouragement. And one thing I do remember about Uncle Ray was his commitment to the Gideons. Always had New Testaments. He'd always give us a bunch of New Testaments when we'd leave to Mexico. And his commitment to the Great Commission, taking the gospel to all the world. He was just relentless, praying for us. Today I have the opportunity and the privilege of leading an organization called Missionary Revival Crusade that my father started in 1959. And right now we have over 40 missionaries in 15 countries around the world with the determined goal and vision and mission to taking the gospel. And Uncle Ray was, even just a couple months ago, was sending money for missionaries. I know his resources were limited, but it was important for him. And it always blessed me and it always touched my heart to hear from him, to receive a card from him, and to be encouraged by him. I saw him probably about 4 months ago, the last time, and just a trooper. We went out to eat with my brother Mark. And my brother Mark is a missionary in Paris, France right now. And he would have loved to be here today. He was just deeply close to my Uncle Ray and Aunt Annie. And he sends his greetings as well as the rest of my brothers and sisters. My sister Joy is here. She's very happy that she could make the opportunity to be here. Thank you.
Hi, in case you haven't had a chance to meet me yet, I'm Ginny. I'm married to Tim. I first met Ray on Valentine's Day of 2013. Tim brought Mike and Ray to a senior connections meeting at our dinner at New Life, where Tim and I go, and Tim had asked me to sit with him. That was the first time I met Ray. What struck me with Ray was his ability to carry on conversation with anybody at the table and to talk to anybody that came around. That was a trait that I would see him use throughout his time with us. I got to meet Janie and Rachel and Bob a year later at an Easter celebration. What struck me about that Easter celebration was the family camaraderie that existed amongst everybody, the fun that they had, even adults participating in an Easter egg hunt. And it was fun. I mean, the kids got to go first, but then we got to go. And the kids had fun hiding the eggs for us. And then there was the idea of, okay, where did that egg go so that we could find it later? But I loved how family and friends and everybody supported Dad when he lost Mike shortly after Tim and I were married. That's what's strong about this family. This family comes together when there's a loss. And then later on when Bob passed and went to his heavenly reward, that was another time when I saw family come together. It wasn't unusual for Tim and I to get a visit from Dad in our apartment when we first were married. He'd come, and then Tim would take his car, and he'd park it in a parking spot, and he'd stay for dinner. When Dad lost his ability to drive, one of the things that was part of our life was Janie would take Dad for rides. Tim and I would visit him on Sundays, and we'd bring a meal, and we'd take him for a ride sometimes. Some of those rides meant going to Beaverton to visit Terry and Becky. Another time was going over to Euphrata to visit the uncles over there and aunts and have family time. We also had times when we would share bringing him food. One of the things that he always looked forward to was Janie's cabbage patch soup. I couldn't make it like Janie, but he ate it. Okay. And one of the other things that was outstanding was Bob would come up and stay for 2 or 3 days with Dad and keep him company. Everybody came together to help support Dad. Dad would also mention the grandkids who came to visit. Oh, I got a visit from Melanie this last week. Or, oh, Matt came to visit. And we had a very nice visit. Or, I got to see so-and-so. So it was, or so-and-so called me. So, or other family, nephews and nieces that visited. Oh, there was one time when Phil and Judy came to visit, and he talked about that. Dad had many cute sayings in his life, and they mentioned some of those in the eulogy, but the very first time I heard one of his cute sayings was, we'd had dinner together. He pushed back from the table, and he said, well, I'm fed up. And oh my goodness, did I do something wrong? And then I saw the half smile on his face and realized he'd had enough to eat. He also, another saying that he had was, my cup has a hole in it. It's empty. And he turned it upside down. That meant he was ready for a refill of coffee or whatever it was he was drinking, lemonade, whatever it was. He never failed to say thank you for a meal. And if I got thank you for a good meal, I knew that that was an adequate meal, but not something that he was really fond of. And maybe later on, not have it for a while. The other thing that he said was, that was a superb meal. And Janie experienced this too. She may have gotten a little bit different phrase, but it was, that was a superb meal. That meant it was over the top, and he could eat that again and again. One such meal was Costco macaroni and cheese. Another thing that Dad was known for was he was in his wheelchair the last 5 months of his life, and he would roll down the hallway, and I'd hear him rolling down the hallway, and he'd peek around the corner and see me sitting in the chair having my coffee, and he'd say, good morning. And I'd say, good morning to you. How are you doing? And he'd say, well, the good Lord woke me up today, so I must be doing pretty good. The other one he'd said to Janie whenever she came by she'd call him and say, hey, Dad, how you doing? He'd say, well, I read the paper this morning, and I wasn't in it, so I must be doing pretty good. He never failed to show gratitude for the things that he had. The last 5 months, he'd come to live with us after being in the care center. The care center took good care of him, he said, but I wanted to be around family. And so he got to be around family the last 5 months of his life. He'd thank me for food. He'd thank us for rides that we got to take together. Janie would come up during the week, and he'd say, I'm going to go up to Concrete and look at the elk. And so she would take him for a ride up to Concrete. Or we'd take him to church with us, and after church he would say, I want clam chowder. That meant we went to Ivers. So we would go have clam chowder at Ivers. Or he'd say, I want you to stop at Safeway and get some chicken, some potato salad, and some coleslaw. So hence the reason why we've got chicken today. We're honoring Dad's final wish. So anyway, whenever Janie came up, she'd bring chicken or fish to visit. And they would watch a Mariners game together. And when they were in the finals, that was an exciting time. Dad loved sports. We would spend Sundays when Rachel would come up, and we would have, we'd watch a Seahawks game. Or we'd play a game. That was another thing that Dad loved, was playing games. Whenever we had a family get-together, we would play apples to apples. Or when Rachel would come up, we'd play spinner. And he enjoyed those. The other thing that he enjoyed doing was putting puzzles together. Janie would come up, and they'd put a puzzle together. And then Tim would work on it with him. And I remember one time going to see Cousin Beatrice, and we put a puzzle together while we were there. Uncle Joe and Aunt Janie and Tim and I were there for lunch with her. Dad loved going on rides. I think I mentioned that. Janie picking him up, taking him on rides. We went to Euphrata. We went to Beaverton. We went up the coast. And another trip that we made was up to Leavenworth. We'd go up to get apples. And when we got apples, he'd always give Tim money and say, get some apples for Larry's deer. Larry was a good friend of Dad's, and he has deer that come down into his yard. He always wanted them to have apples. Dad's trait of being able to converse with everyone, that was showing kindness to others, his dry sense of humor, loving others. It was evident in his actions. One such time that he talked about, or that Stephanie recounted what recently was, there was a family dinner, and they were having creamed peas, mashed potatoes, and wasn't sure what the meat was at that particular time. She didn't remember that. But Dad quietly got up, took the potatoes over to the counter, got a spoon to put in them. But before he put the spoon into the potatoes, he put it into some horseradish, and then he stuck it in. And he came back and put the potatoes back on the table. And then he waited to see who got it the first time. Janie and Tim have fond memories. Tim has a fond memory of going to Mexico, like Ben was talking about. And they got down there, and he told Tim that, "You're going to stay here and come back with Mark, Ben's brother." So Tim and Mark came back, and in the process of coming back, they stopped in Texas at a hotel, and it was a huge one. And Tim and Mark pretended that Mark was getting married, and they had to see the honeymoon suite up on the top floor. So they rode the elevator up there and saw the honeymoon suite. That was one of their adventures resultant of Dad having Tim come back with Mark. Janie and Tim and Rachel all remember a trip to Southern California to go to Disneyland, and the vehicle stopping or breaking down. And Ray, Dad, and Mom went into town to get it fixed and left the kids with the tent trailer. They had a great time. When they got back, they headed on down to Disneyland. And if you look out at the pictures a little bit later on, there's a picture that was a sketch of Mike that was sketched at Disneyland. Each one of the kids got a picture. One of the memories that Janie shared was being tucked in at night, and Dad would come in and he'd say, "Okay, it's time to take your pills." And he'd have two M&Ms for each one of them and hand it to them. That was their pills. Dad impacted so many lives in his life. So many people came to us at times. Tim would take Dad to church, to a men's thing. And one time, a guy by the name of Neil came up to him and said, "Do you remember me?" And Dad kind of looked at him. He said, "I used to work with you at Coast to Coast. In fact, you trained me." Another time, Sean came up to him. He was our youth pastor and said, "Do you remember me? You were my Sunday school teacher at Crossview. Whenever we went to a Gideon potluck, we could count on Dad having tons of people to talk to. He was very conversational and spending time with talking to everyone that seemed to be there. Whenever he went to Bible studies with Tim, he met men that go to his Bible studies and he would talk to them. We had a barbecue out in Snohomish at the house one time, and one of the guys afterwards, more than one actually, would come up and say, "We so enjoyed talking to you, your dad, Tim. He's such an interesting man." One of the people that couldn't make it tonight was really wanting to consider Dad as a second father, as his father. Asa wrote this: "Your dad was a great blessing in my life. I will always remember his heart in giving himself and always showing God's light in love and grace. But most of all, not judging one's past. He loved. Yes, he loved God with all his heart. He loved his neighbor as himself. I appreciate his willingness to help give a hand up and a hand out. I could go on and on. He was there for me in prison. Always had a great smile, any word about God. I will not forget he was my father, brother, and friend. God has a friend in Ray Waltner, and what a beautiful friendship. I look forward to having an opportunity to see him soon. I won't forget what he told my wife. The Bible is the roadmap to my life." Just a funny story about Asa. When Dad was getting to the point where he shouldn't be climbing ladders, Janie got a call from Asa and said, "He's climbing a 12-foot ladder to clean the gutters. Do you want him doing that?" She says, "No, take the ladder and hide it." Later on, this last December, when I was talking to Dad, we were talking about losses he had experienced. And we were going over how up until 5 years ago, he was still driving. He was still climbing ladders. And at that point, he said, "Yeah, until somebody took my ladder and hit it." Dad loved family get-togethers, and they had legend and epic family reunions. He talked often about the family reunions, how they would travel across miles to eastern Washington, over to Spokane, down to Oregon, to just spend time with family. Just catching up on life and where everybody was in their process. And you know, on January 23rd, I can only imagine the family reunion that took place. And I bet it's still going on because of the epic family reunions. And one of the things that I can see more than anything is when he walked into the gates of heaven, Jesus standing there saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant."
Well, thank you so much to the family for sharing those stories. It really gives us a glimpse into the life of Ray. I want us to start out by looking at two very powerful words. And the first word we've already talked about a bit, it's loss, L-O-S-S. And loss just means that we lost something. And today we're acknowledging that we lost something really precious when we lost Ray. You can tell by the stories, the hole he's going to leave. And loss does have a way of leaving holes in our lives. And so with Ray gone, life will not be the same for us. You know, family traditions for the family are going to be different. They won't be the same. When we go to church, we won't see Ray sitting there. And as we've already heard, we're not going to hear those sayings anymore. Where did he come up with those? Does anybody know? Because he had them. I don't know how he did it, but Ray had a saying for everything. And even though you knew he may have said it a lot of times, he made you feel special when he said it to you. It was really quite a gift. I don't know how he did it. My wife, Monica, was a few years ago, was at the doctor's office, and she was in there, and she saw Ray sitting there. And they hadn't seen each other for quite a while, so she went over and said hello, and it was clear after a couple minutes that Ray didn't quite recognize who she was. So Monica began explaining who she was, and finally it dawned on Ray who she was, and this is what he said. He said, "Oh, Monica, I'm so sorry. I didn't recognize you at first. You got a new jacket." Okay, who comes up with that? I mean, it's absolutely brilliant. Took an awkward situation and made it feel comfortable. That's what he did. He did it all the time. And in this way that he had, you could tell that Ray had an impact on people all around him, just in his friendliness and the way he acted. You know, Ray and Annie raised 5 children, and that in itself is a big accomplishment. But they did so much more. They brought other people in. We just heard about this young man. And they did so much. They served others because of their love for Jesus. Ray and Annie were really quite a formidable team, and so was the whole family. In fact, if you think about this church, they were a significant part of the history right here at CrossView. Of course, it was called the Free Methodist Church back then. I don't know the number of people affected by Ray in a positive way, but it was big. We know he taught Sunday school. He'd had the Gideons, the nursing home, prison ministry, all those things, and just wherever he was. Because wherever he was, Ray exuded Jesus Christ. That's who Ray was. And because of this, we feel the loss all the more. So with Ray, we feel the loss of a father, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, an uncle, a cousin, a friend, a Sunday school teacher. Whatever our relationship to Ray is, we feel that loss. Now, if all we had were the loss, if that's all we had, well, we'd be in trouble because we'd never really find healing because that loss would stay there. But the second word we're going to look at today is a different word. It's a very powerful word. It's the word hope. It's actually one of the most powerful words or the most impactful words in the Christian faith. H-O-P-E, hope. 2 4-letter words, but dramatically different in their impact. This word hope is so significant to Christians. And Ray was a devout follower of Jesus Christ. And because of this, Ray was a man of hope. He was a man of hope. I want to quickly look at three things that Ray hoped for. And we've actually kind of alluded to some of them already in the things that were shared. The first hope that Ray had when he died was that he would be with Jesus. That was his first hope, that he'd be with Jesus. I remember being in these rooms over here, sometimes down in that little echoey basement, and I remember Ray leading songs. I remember him leading the song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And he would lead that song. Okay, the guy was fearless. I remember there were times when he forgot the words to songs. And Annie was playing the piano, and Ray, they didn't miss a beat. Ray just kept going, and somewhere he brought it back. And Annie would just keep playing. But you know, when he sang, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, it was the real deal. It was the real thing when he sang it. I apologize if I sniff in the microphone. Melanie, you got me when you were speaking. See, Ray's hope looked forward to meeting Jesus in death in a way that we can only imagine now. We can't even experience Jesus the way Ray knows Jesus now. So the Bible tells us that when we're absent from the body, we're present with the Lord. So that means when we die, we're with the Lord. So Ray is with Jesus. And he undoubtedly, right now, knows Jesus in a way beyond he even imagined. Because our imaginations are very limited when it comes to God. So we know that right now, Ray is experiencing something wonderful. And we don't need to be timid about this. Ray is with God. We don't need to be timid about saying that. You know what? He's not worrying right now about how to pay the bills. He's not experiencing any aches or pains. Ray is in a really good place. So let that bring you comfort. Ray is in a good place. The second hope that Ray had, and this is something that Jenny talked about, is that he would be reunited with his loved ones. So this is a wonderful promise of the Christian faith, that even though our primary joy will be to be with God, for those that go before us, we get a chance to see them again. And this is a wonderful hope. So, you know, Ray loves a good reunion. And so we know he had that reunion. Right now, he's experiencing the reality of a family reunion with Annie, Mike, Bob, and Lydia. You know, they were married. Annie and Ray were married 50 years, but it seemed like that wasn't long enough. It seemed like it should have gone longer. And you know what? A father should never lose a son, let alone two sons, and you should never lose a grandchild. That was a sorrowful time for Ray, but that sorrow is gone. He no longer has that sorrow. That hope is fulfilled. And again, let that bring you comfort. Ray is with his family. So the third hope that Ray has, he still has. Excuse me here. The problem when you get up here and you love someone and you have to do the message is that you cry with everyone. And so I'm taking my own advice, and I'm okay about crying in front of you. Is that all right? So the third hope that Ray has is a hope that he still has. Okay, this hope is not yet fulfilled. And the hope that he has, the third hope, is that he's waiting for us. He's waiting for the rest of the family to come to him. Now, that won't happen while we're living, so Ray's going to have to wait. Ray's just going to have to wait for that one. But while he's waiting, he's had two hopes fulfilled, and he's waiting the third, and he's in a good place while he's waiting. Now, all of this is great for Ray. Ray's in a good place, but what about us? What about those of us right now that are sitting here? Those of us that are feeling the loss, what is there for us? And fortunately, hope has something for us too. See, the God that Ray serves in the Bible is called the God of hope. There's an interesting verse. It's written by the Apostle Paul. And if you know the Apostle Paul, you know he had loss, he had struggles, all this stuff. And Romans 15:13, he wrote this verse. I'm just going to kind of paraphrase it. He said this. He said that if you trust the God of hope, that God will fill you with joy and peace, and that ultimately you'll overflow with hope through the power of God's Spirit. This is an amazing promise to us. In the middle of our loss, we have hope. And we have hope that as we trust God with the loss of Ray, God will bring us healing. Now, ultimately, that healing will take us to joy and to peace. So we hope for that day. We hope for that day. Now, how that process looks for each one will be very different. For some, the healing will come quickly. For some, the healing might go on a few years. Everyone will heal differently from the loss of Ray. But for each of us, we can be confident that as we move forward, as we trust God, that a day will come when peace and joy, they win. Peace and joy win. And the pain of the loss is defeated. There will always be a sense of loss. That's okay. But it won't hurt so much. And it won't be so overwhelming. If you're feeling overwhelmed right now by the loss of Ray, look forward in hope to that day when God's peace and joy comes and the sting of that loss is lessened. God is present to help us. This is the hope that we have. Now, it's going to work different for everybody. So here's kind of how it's working for me. I see Tim at church, and the last few weeks, every time I've seen Tim, I kind of hurt. I think about him. I think about Janie and Rachel. I kind of hurt, and I think about Ray. I'm like, oh, and it just kind of hurts. And then I started thinking about Ray, and I started having memories of Ray that go back, I think, at least 55 years. And I was thinking about one time, we were in junior high, so that I guess is middle school now, but I still remember this. Ray was teaching a class, and he was teaching about making choices. And he was telling, I still remember the story. He was telling the story about a young man who made some bad choices. And he was encouraging us as young people to make the right choices. And right in the middle of it, he started crying. He started crying. And I get emotional because back then, it was just awkward, all right? That, you're in seventh grade and your teacher's crying. It's a little bit awkward, okay? But as an adult, now, looking back, that he would cry for me, that he would cry for you, wow. That says something to that. That says something about Ray. And I just took strength in that it's okay. It's okay to have emotion and love people and experience that and help them. I still remember that. I also remember a time with Monica. Sorry here, excuse me. That we were going to the Do It Center. And we were in the parking lot. We pulled in the parking lot, we got out, and we were walking over to the front door. And there was Ray. He was, I don't know what he was doing, he was outside, but he saw us. And he flashed, you know, the Ray smile. That Ray smile came on, and we began this intersection. We were going to intersect. He was coming from one end, we were coming there, and we were meeting at the door, and he just started smiling. And this is what he did. Have you ever seen in, like, these movies or something where there's a doorman at, a really expensive hotel? He kind of did that, and he stood over by the front door and gave us a big smile. And he said, well, here, let me open the door for you. And then he took his foot and he tapped that little pressure pad that's on the door. And he just tapped that little pressure pad. And the door, it was so cheesy. It was so cheesy, and yet it was so wonderful. And I hate to admit this, but I do that today. All because of Ray. All because of Ray. Except I do the optic light. Here, let me get the door for you, whatever. But it's all because of Ray. That's the power of Ray. And what I found is that as I've had these memories, that the pain has been lessened. I found that God's moved in and he's given me really a sense that the pain is less because I still have Ray's influence in my life today. There's really a part of Ray with me. And here's the thing. As you put your trust in God, he will do the same for you. It will just look different. I don't know how God will do it. It may be that right when you're struggling the most and the hurt is so strong, that God will divinely step in and give you peace. I don't know how he's going to do it. It could be that God will just comfort you through someone else. And that's really part of what we're doing here today. Let's make sure we comfort the family. Let's comfort each other. But the thing is, hope encourages us that joy and peace will come to overcome the pain of loss. But you know, there's even something else. Hope offers more, and we've already talked about this. It's this great teaching in Christianity is that third hope of race, that the separation from loved ones is only temporary. All who place their trust in Jesus will one day be reunited with Ray. So it turns out that this hope that Ray has, that he's waiting for us, is our hope too. We actually have the same hope as Ray. Ray's waiting for us, and we're waiting for one day to be reunited with him. Now, of course, again, the main attraction will be God, but it will be really good to see Ray again. It'll be good to see Ray and the family. I hope, at the risk of being theologically incorrect, I'm sure this is, I kind of have a feeling that when I show up, Ray's going to go, "Here, Glenn, let me get the door for you." And he's going to do that. I just kind of see Ray doing that. Or he's going to have, I bet he's got some new sayings from being up there, right? So as we end this time together, let's allow the power of hope to overcome the sting of the loss. And yes, we miss Ray and we'll continue to miss him. But as we remember Ray, let's just remember to continue to thank God for the gift that Ray is to us. So allow God in the coming season to minister to you with hope. Let's go ahead and bow our heads in prayer. Father, we just thank you for this time together. I pray right now for every person in this room that's feeling the loss, that right now you would give them hope that you are with them, that they would have the hope that you will process life with them, and that the sting of the loss will end over time. I just pray for your peace upon each person. We thank you for this, all this family here. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're almost done with this part of the service, but I want to give just a few directions for the rest. So again, on behalf of the Waltner family, thank you so much for coming. Thank you for all the to the family members that shared, Bill for leading us in song. And really thank you to just all the, Pastor Kyle and all the people here at CrossView Church. Thank you so much for all you've done for the family. We're just really appreciative for all that. And just a reminder, I do encourage you when we go to this reception to be ready to share things that you might want to talk about. But most importantly, be a support to each other. We are a family here. Let's be family to each other, because we're kind of moving now into more of a time of celebration as we come together. Now, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray over the food now, because once we get over there, we might be kind of divided. I'm going to pray over the food. And after I pray, but don't leave. Don't leave yet, because we still have one more thing coming up. But when we do dismiss, please leave through the back and walk out the back, take a right, go that way. You're going to follow the signs for the fireside room. That's how you're going to go out. So make sure when you leave, go out that way, take a right. Okay, so here's the thing. We have, I'll pray a blessing over the food. Let me do that first, and then I'll tell you the last part. So here we go. Father, we just thank you for this time coming up, this fellowship time. Help it to be a joyous time and a healing time in Jesus' name. We just thank you for this food. We thank you for all you're going to do. Amen. All right, so here's the final instruction. The family thought that it would be really perfect if the last word of this service could come from Ray. So the family has a video that they're going to play. And so after you watch this video of Ray, then you're dismissed. Just go out the back. But here's Ray.
I thank the Lord that he's given me a long life. I'm going to be 90 years old here in another month or so. But I can only say God has been exceptionally good to me. His mercy is overflowing here. I was reading in 1 Samuel, the 22nd chapter. The first verse and the last verse of the chapter said that God is my rock and my salvation. And in him, I can trust him, and I can verify that God has given me a very, very good life. And when I'll see him, I don't know, but he's given me new days every day to serve him, and that's my desire. God bless you. Amen. I'll see you in heaven.
Thank you.